Welcome to Mahatma Education Society's e-learning channel. This is the 13th of a series of lectures on Introduction to Mechanical Vibrations. We are in the chapter Free, Undamped, Single Degree of Freedom Vibration Systems. The outline of the lecture will be, we are going to continue with the numerical solving. In the last lecture also, we had solved a number of problems, around 5. Now we continue with the numericals. Now this is a lever, a rectangle lever with one mass positioned over here and supported by a spring, and the dimensions are given to you, and the system is oscillating about pivot O. We are required to find out what is the value of omega n, right? So let me write what is kinetic energy. So it is half times I about O axis into theta dot square. That is half times, what is that, m into L square into theta dot square, right? So it is basically the second moment of mass about the pivot, right? Or simply what you can do is, you can just write half times I about O into theta dot square. Why? Because this value of B is more than, or it is not that small, right? And I can actually have a different value of the distance, right? So let us stick to this one, half into I about O into the dot square, and the P can be written as half times K times, what is the amount of deformation for the spring? That is A theta, right? So A theta whole squared, and plus, now if suppose I'm having a mass supported like this and it is pivoted over here, and if I'm having a mass something like this, something like a pendulum, okay, so there will be no potential energy by virtue of the mass in this case, and but in this case I will be having a potential energy by virtue of the mass because of its configuration, right? So in this case also I am having something like this, but the case is somewhat different. This one is a case of an inverted pendulum, something like this, right? So when I disturb this, it will be a negative potential, right? So instead of plus, I will be having a minus over here, and what is the height difference that we are going to attain if this moves downwards, right? So this height difference, let us call it as h, right? So initially it was like this, then it becomes something like this, okay, for very small theta. So what is the amount here, right? So this distance is b, right? And what is the distance? This distance is equal to b times, what is that, theta, cos theta. So this h is equal to, from here to here, b times, so b minus b cos theta. So it is b into 1 minus cos theta, that is the height difference between two instants. So I am going to convert this cos of theta in terms of an equivalent term that we had seen in the earlier lectures. So cos of theta will be approximated by 1 minus theta square by 2. Why? Because we want to convert a non-linear problem in terms of an equivalent linear problem. So we can do that by replacing this cos of theta with this one. So basically the first two terms will be cancelled out here. I will be having half times b times theta square, right? Okay, now so what is the contribution of the mass now? So it is m into g into h, that is the potential. So m into g into h is given by here, that is half times b times theta square, right? And if I combine this, I am having k a square minus half and theta square, separate it out, you are having mgb theta square. So whatever is there within the brackets is nothing but kt equivalent. In the first case, I naught is itself I equivalent, and then you take the root of kt equivalent upon I equivalent, and this is what you get, right? So this numerical is having a flywheel that is pivoted over here at the rim. The mass is given to you, and when I disturb this system, we have the time period of oscillation measured as 1.22 seconds for oscillation. We are required to find out the mass moment of inertia about the geometric axis, that is about the center of gravity axis, right? So it is something kind of a torus, the rim, right? Now ke is equal to, what is that, half into the mass moment of inertia about the axis of oscillation into theta dot squared. Let us assume that the theta is the angle of oscillation, right? So what is I about O axis? I about axis is I about CG axis plus the mass into distance between the CG axis and the pivot axis, squared of that. So let me call it as H squared. So what is H here? It is nothing but the radius, right? That is given by 0.3 upon 2 is 0.15 meters, right? So half into I about CG is not known to me for now, plus mass is known to me, 35 into 0.15 squared, right, theta dot squared. So whatever is there within the brackets, this entire thing is I equivalent, kilogram meter squared, right? So what is PE? So PE is, so it's a case of a compound pendulum, right? One example of a compound pendulum. So it is M into G into the height difference. Right. So what height difference we are getting when the CG is shifted from its rest position to some other position? So this H is nothing but this 0.15 times, right, 1 minus cos theta. So I hope you know this. So it is nothing but this is 0.15, and this is, this value is when this one goes up over here, right? So 0.15 cos of theta, right, if this is the theta value. So 1.15 this value minus 0.15 cos theta, that is this value, I am ending with this H, okay? So then you remove the cos of theta, replace it with the equivalent term, mg into 0.15 into, it is 1 minus, and this one is 1 minus theta square by 2, right? So basically I end up with half times theta square, right? So I can write it as half times mg into 0.15 into theta squared. So this will be kt equivalent, right? So we are given with the time period of oscillation tp, that is 1.22 seconds, that is nothing but 2 pi by omega n, right? And which is 2 pi into under root of, so omega n is root of kt equivalent upon I equivalent, so it is 1 upon omega n. So I should be having here I equivalent upon kt equivalent, right? So what is the unknown over here? So kt equivalent is known to you, the term within the brackets in the potential energy, and in I equivalent I am having unknown as the I about center of gravity, and which is to be found out. So when you put the values, you get the I about center of gravity axis as 1.154 kilogram meter squared. Now this one is a very pretty simple example again, okay? So a number of springs and only one mass. So what you can do is you can combine the first three springs, they are joined end to end, and basically the force in each of the springs is the same, so this combination is in series. So I can have k 1 2 3, they are in series combination. So let us combine all the three springs into a single spring k 1 2 3, and I have 1 upon k 1 2 3 as 1 upon k1 plus 1 upon k2 plus 1 upon k3. Addition of the reciprocals of this is equal to the reciprocal of the equivalent stiffness. So from this you are going to get the value of k 1 2 3, right? So I am having the k 1 2 3 over here, then a mass over here, right? And now you can combine this k4 and k5, right? And giving displacement to the mass will give me the same amount of deformation for springs having k4 and k5 as the stiffness. So you can combine that. So you have your k4 5 as a combination of k4 and k5. So it is k4 plus k5 because they are parallel in nature. This was in series, right? So I'm having K4-5 as a combination, and you can have the K equivalent of the entire system as K1-2-3 plus K4-5. Why? Because both of these again are in parallel configuration. They are having the same amount of deformation, right? So M equivalent is equal to M itself, no change, only one mass is there, right? And the unknown over here is the mass. You are given with the frequency value. So what is that? So frequency is 10 hertz, that is nothing but omega n divided by 2 pi. So I should be having 1 upon 2 pi under root of K equivalent upon M equivalent. So K equivalent is known to me upon M equivalent is equal to M only, right? So this is the unknown, and you put the values in the formula, you will get the value as 0.422 kilograms. Okay, so this is an example of a cylinder or a disc that is rolling without any slip in a concave cylindrical surface, right? It is a cavity. Okay, so this is the next position that we have shown. Initially the cylinder is supposed to be resting over here with P as the contact point, right? Something like this. Okay, now I want to find the omega n of the system for small oscillations about this axis over here, AA axis, right? So what is kinetic energy? It is half times mass into velocity square. I am talking about the kinetic energy of the translation for the mass, and then kinetic energy of rotation for the mass, right? So it depends on convenience, how comfortable you are in solving the problem. If you want to take directly the motion about the actual axis of oscillation, then you are free to do it. Or sometimes if you are free to break it up into pure motions with respect to CG, then also you can get the same answer, right? So let us go with the motion of the CG, right? So now I am writing the kinetic energy of translation for the CG. So what is the distance moved by the center of gravity of the mass? So it is from here to this one, right? So this will be arc distance, something like this. But assuming that theta is very small, right? Theta is very small. Why? Because I am converting the nonlinear in terms of a linear one, right? So then the value of this arc distance will be how much? So this cavity radius is R, capital R, and this cylinder radius is small r, right? This is small r. So what is the value of this? So the capital R minus small r is the distance from here to here, capital R minus small r, right? So what is the distance covered by the center of gravity? It is capital R minus small r into angle theta, right? And when theta is very small, this will be almost like a straight line. So half times m times capital R minus small r into theta, that is the distance covered. I want the velocity, so take the derivative, and I want the square of this velocity, so it is square of this. Okay, so basically this one is kinetic energy for pure translation, that is I am talking with respect to the moment of the CG alone, right? Plus I want to add the kinetic energy for rotation also, right? It is rotation about the CG axis, okay, pure motion. So what is the rotation about CG, right? So you want to find first what is the effective angle turned by the cylinder in space about the CG axis. Let us assume that I am marking some small radius over here initially, and after rolling to some other instant, I am having the same mark, that is over here now. Okay, so this particular point has traversed a path something like this, right? Okay, and let me assign some angle, that is phi, this phi as measured from the line joining this new CG position with the new point of contact, right? That is for convenience again. So let us have this as a phi. So what is the angle turned by the system or by the mass. So, I am having this initial position something like this and final position, let me assume that the CG stays in that location only, the final position is like this. And I am trying to actually measure this phi something like this, right. So, what is this value here? So, if I drop a vertical over here, this is nothing but this theta itself, right. So, effective angle turned in space is nothing but the difference between the two positions of this mark, right. The final position minus initial position, right. So, but phi is measured from here, from this particular location, right. Right. So, what is the effective angle turned? Effective angle turned in space by the cylinder equal to phi minus theta, right. That is about CG axis, right. So, I want here kinetic energy for pure rotation, that is half times the mass moment of inertia about CG axis, that is given by mr squared by 2 into the velocity squared. So, velocity is a function of the amount of angle turned in space, that is this one. So, I am having phi dot minus theta dot squared of that. I hope it is okay. So, it is half times m capital R minus small r squared theta dot squared plus half times m r squared by 2. And how do I convert this phi in terms of theta now? So, do we have any relationship over here? So, I can just observe this particular arc length from P to Q over here. So, this is same as this arc length of the cylinder, right. So, this arc length is equal to this arc length, right. So, I can write here, let me write somewhere over here, capital R times theta is equal to, what is that? It is small r times phi, agreed? So, phi can be converted to small theta in this fashion. So, I want here phi dot, which I can write it as capital R upon small r theta dot minus theta dot squared of this, right? So, in this again half times m r minus r squared theta dot squared plus half times m r squared by 2, and it is nothing but capital R minus small r upon small r. So, r upon r minus 1, I will take it outside, right, and this theta dot square is common, right, squared of this. So, we can combine this, right. So, it is r square over here, r square over here is cancelled out, right. So, it is m into r minus r squared plus m into r minus r squared divided by 2 theta dot squared. So, basically I am having this thing that is there here also. So, it is 1 plus 1 upon 2, it is 3 upon 2, half times 3 upon 2 m into r minus r squared of this theta dot squared, right. So, whatever is there within the brackets is I equivalent, fine. And what is PE now? So, PE is as usual, we had solved the problems earlier, that is m times g times the height difference of the center of gravity of the cylinder. So, what is this h now? This h. So, what is that? So, it is capital R minus small r minus capital R minus small r cos of theta. So, I want this particular value of h, right. So, it is capital R minus small r minus capital R minus small r into cos of h, cos of theta, that is 1 minus cos of theta. Now, convert this cos of theta in terms of replacement as 1 minus theta square by 2, where 1 is cancelled out and I am having this thing as half times theta square, right. Okay. So, it is basically half times mg capital R minus small r into theta square. Right. So, the term within the brackets, this one is, that is kt equivalent. Okay. Now, you are having omega n as under root of kt equivalent by I equivalent. So when you put the values this and this, you are going to get this relation, under root of 2g upon 3 r minus r. Now simple pendulum, same concepts here. M, the length will be measured from the pivot to the center of gravity of this mass or bob, right? Kinetic energy is half times mass moment of inertia about O axis, right? That is nothing but mass into distance squared, the second moment of mass. So this is basically I equivalent. What is PE? It is mgh. H is nothing but L times 1 minus cos theta, straight away I am writing here. And this 1 minus cos theta is nothing but half times theta squared, right? So basically I end up with half times mgl into theta squared, where this mgl is nothing but kt equivalent. So what do you get from here? Omega n is root of mgl upon ml squared. So there is no m here, so l and l over here, it is under root of g by l. So what is the conclusion for this? If I change the mass to a new mass, then there is virtually no effect in the time period or omega n value, right? Irrespective of the mass, the value of omega n or time period remains same, and it is a function of the this length. If I reduce the length, value of frequency increases, right? So this also I had discussed this earlier. If I reduce the length of or the size of the parts of the vibrating system, it tends to increase the frequency value. So this is one very important example here. Length, if I am reducing here, the value of omega n increases, right? And if I increase the length, then the value of omega n reduces. Okay. Compound pendulum. So what's the difference between simple and compound pendulum is, for simple pendulum I am having a concentrated mass, a lumped mass at the end, and this is a simple thread or a rigid link which is very light, right? And compound pendulum may be actually it may be having a distribution of mass, okay, where the cross section may be uniformly distributed along the length, or it may be ununiform. Okay, so any irregular shaped object, let us say the thickness is constant all over, so I can take any point other than the CG, and this becomes a compound pendulum, right? So I am having a say point over here, O axis, I am having the CG somewhere over here. So practically if I ask somebody, suppose where is the position of CG, experimentally if I try to find where is the position of CG, so what you need to do? So you just need to actually assume some two points, arbitrary points, as points of suspension, and let us say I am having some thread over here, so it is going to actually, this CG will be aligned with the this point, okay, it will be in the vertical axis, right? And again at some other point, arbitrary point, you try to suspend this particular mass with the thread, and it is going to actually rest something like this. So this will be vertical one, so wherever this meets will be the CG, right? So experimentally you can find where is the CG of the given irregular shaped body, right? Now if I suspend this compound pendulum at any other point other than the CG, let us say it is OO axis, then let us call it as a h distance, right, from the CG to the OO axis. Now let us find what is the let us say the mass value is m, so what is the value of omega n? So what is ke now? That is half times, what is that, mass moment of inertia about O axis into the theta squared, and this is half times I about CG plus the mass into distance between the two axis squared of that theta squared. So this is basically I equivalent. So I may not have a proper ready-made formula for I about CG. So earlier I had taken a large length of the lever with considerable small dimensions, right, the formula was ml square by 12 for the CG, right, about the CG. Now it is not so over here. For an irregular shaped body, I don't have a ready-made formula of I about CG, right? So I just need to just use the value of I about CG, write it as usual, right, without any breakup of the formula, I don't know it, okay? So this is what I can do it best. What is P now? It is mgh. Mg into h is what? Okay, height difference, what is that? So this h is the distance from CG to the pivot into 1 minus cos of theta. So we have done this number of times now. So it is nothing but half times mgh into theta squared. So convert this cos of theta into equivalent terms and cancel out the ones. I'm having this mgh as kt equivalent, and what you end up with is omega n is equal to mgl or mgh, sorry, in this case, divided by I about cg axis plus mh squared. So this is the general formula, right? Now lastly, we are having a U-tube manometer. It is filled up with some liquid of some density rho, right? And when the liquid level is at rest, right, or when the liquid is at rest, let us assume that actually the actual distance between the two levels is L, right, for the liquid column. So I'm having L, right, and I'm trying to give a small disturbance to the system, either by giving some small movement to the system or giving a small puff of air on one side of the limb, right? So air puff. Okay, you insert some velocity of air, thereby you can displace the liquid. So now I'm displacing it over here, right? So air is being puffed up over here, not over here, right? So basically you are giving some disturbance, and then we are required to find out the oscillations happening of the liquid column in this. Okay, so what is this K now? So K is given by half times the mass of the liquid column. So which mass? It is the entire mass, because each and every particle of the liquid, right, it is in motion, each and every particle of the liquid, right? So I need to consider the entire mass of the liquid which is in motion for our calculations of kinetic energy, right? So half times m times into what the amount of displacement for each of the particle, it is on an average it is x, right? So it is displaced by x over here on the right hand side limb, it is displaced by x, fine. So half times m times v squared. So what is the value of m here? Suppose the density is given to us, that is rho, right? So what is density? So density is mass per unit volume. So what is mass now? So mass is equal to density to volume, which is nothing but area times length, right? So rho a l, that is the mass of the liquid column into x dot square. So basically this one is m equivalent kilograms. Now I'll talk about potential energy. What is that? Now you can imagine that, just leave aside the okay, you can assume here that you can displace this particular amount of water or liquid from the one of the limbs to the other limbs, right? So initially I had this as the position of the levels of the liquid, and now after some disturbance, this level has fallen down to this one and this has risen up, something like this. So we can assume that the other part remaining as it is. Okay, so this particular amount of liquid has been physically shifted to the other part of the limb. Okay, so I can take the center of gravity of this particular part and it is being shifted onto this particular part, right? So what is the amount that has been shifted here, or what is the height difference to which the amount has been shifted? That is equal to how much? So the cg over here will be at distance of x upon 2 in the left limb, and here it is equal to x upon 2 again on the right limb upwards. So total amount of height difference between the two center of gravity positions is x upon 2 plus x upon 2 is x. So it is mass of the liquid displaced. So what is the mass of the liquid displaced now? We will not consider the entire mass here. So what is that? So it is mass displaced, right, into g into height difference. What is that here? Rho times a times, and what is the length? In this case it is x, right? This is the amount of liquid displaced from here to here physically, that is what we are assuming, right, into g times, and the height difference is nothing but x only. This is rho times a times x square into g. So I can just convert it in the form of half times something of x squared. So what is remaining here? Half times rho a g, and it is 2, so that it can be cancelled out, 2, this 2 and this 2, right? So this 2 times rho a g is nothing but k equivalent, Okay, so omega n should be under root of k equivalent, that is 2 times rho ag divided by rho al, right? That is m equivalent. So this rho and a will be cancelled out, and I'm having root of 2g upon l. That is the answer. In this lecture, we had continued with solving a number of numericals, around 4 in number. So all of these examples are pretty simple to solve. And in the coming lectures also, we are going to see how to solve some problems related to this chapter, and which will be somewhat more complex, right? Hope you understood the contents. Thank you.